Marley with his epic song, Guiltiness, one of his epic songs, I should say. It was from his acclaimed album, Exodus, that was released in 1977 through Island Records. This is Leid Stories. I'm Yatrice Leid. I'm so sorry that we had a little rough start, but we're still having some issues, it appears, and it has to do with connectivity and we're working to work out the kinks. So bear with us. Bear with us. Let me see what's going on here. Okay.
Am I being heard? Okay, there's an incredible echo, and I can't hear you too well. All right, so let's get started. Even with the kinks, and we'll see where we go. And this raises a point today in getting started. But let's hope that everything has been worked out and we can continue. I was making the point that we need your help. We need your financial support so that all these glitches and problems that we experience from time to time will not happen. So please consider making a donation to your favorite station, PRN, so that we can improve. And we really do need to do that. Today, we're starting late. We have mechanical problems and other problems that are in the way. Help us get them out of the way by making a donation. And please make it a point to write or to designate the ordination is coming at the behest and the bequest of your favorite program, your favorite programs on the station. Thank you so much. All right, so Donald Trump, I had to start off with him because yesterday a group of journalists had assembled in their usual spot where they hold the news conferences, and they were awaiting a press briefing. And the ceiling suddenly gave way, a part of the ceiling suddenly gave way, and down out of the roof, or the ceiling of the room, falls a rat. Now, they're saying this was a mouse. Well, I'm saying that might have been a mighty big, fat mouse to have caused the ceiling to cave in. And people were scampering all over the place. All kinds of mayhem broke out because what? A rat came through the ceiling. And my mind went directly to Baltimore, where Trump had said such cruel things about Baltimore and places like it that are rat infested. Yeah. Well, you better call somebody to fix up your rat infested White House, Mr. President. Because even a rat wants to get out of there. And it also, you know, I thought it was kind of funny because it's a rat and you have all these people.
And whenever you talk about a problem and fixing a problem, you're talking about money. It takes money to get it done. And so I will start off the program today. You heard for yourself the difficulty I've had in just getting started today. And it's nobody's fault. It's about how things go in the electronic world. It means that things have to be, run down to figure out where the disconnect is and how to get it fixed. And that means that I would like you to come into the breach and help us fix it. And that means I'm asking you to make a donation so that we can straighten this matter out. It has happened many times before, and so we should fix it. I need you to help us fix it. And that is by making a donation to PRN and just help us get over this hump. It's not a major hump, but it is a hump. And we don't need to be bested by technology. We need to be in charge of it, not it being in charge of us and disrupting our program. So I'm asking you to consider making a donation today, and to help us get this thing patched up, so that we have smooth sailing from here on. Everybody's doing a great job, but sometimes, you know, technology has its own idea of who's in charge. And it tells you sometimes that, we know you want to do this, but in the meantime, we are going to do that. So this is how it works. Please consider making a donation. I don't think it would take millions of dollars at all to fix, but it is an expense and we should have it fixed immediately. So consider that, please. How do you do that? You donate to PRN. There, you go to the website and you see the contact information for making a donation. And please note, Leid Stories. I want to know that my folks are out there. They have a great loyalty to the program, and we need to get this fixed. So thank you so much for your donations in advance. Okay, so I was talking about Trump having to eat his words again. He had so decried and really was so foul in discussing cities like Baltimore as being rat-infested, and said, you know, very uncomplimentary things in that regard. And yesterday, while reporters were sitting down preparing for some kind of press briefing in the press room, out of the ceiling comes a rat. Now, they're just making it plain that it was a mouse. I'm saying it was a rat. Okay? It was a rat. And it fell through the ceiling and sent people scampering all over the place as if they had never seen such a thing before. And I was so happy that they had the opportunity to see a rat. And in the White House, this was a highfalutin rat. This was no ordinary rat. This was a classy rat. So now maybe Trump has to rethink his notion of, you know, when communities and neighborhoods are falling apart, since he used that as an indicator of the level of life, the quality of life in these forsaken neighborhoods that are rat-infested. The same goes to you, too, Mr. Trump. You better go look in the ceilings for other rats that might be waiting for you there. I want to start off by sending good thoughts and wishes to Bernie Sanders, who was hospitalized with a blockage, an artery blockage yesterday. And he has come through. They put in a stent, and it has helped relieve the problem. But it is not a solution to the problem. When you reach the point, when you have a situation where you have blockage to the main arteries that feed the heart, you're dealing with a serious problem. So we can expect that Sanders is going to get off the campaign trail for a while, because that takes precedence over everything. He's 78 years old, and he needs the strength that he has to tolerate this procedure and to heal and to get about the business of getting back to his regular life. But I'm sure it was a scare to him yesterday as he was campaigning and suddenly felt these pains, and people pulled him off. He was lecturing and talking and campaigning. And this reminds us all that in life there are priorities. They may not be your priorities, but they will soon become your priorities, because your body simply cannot be pushed beyond a certain point. So in all of this, I know he's a very positive person and a hopeful person, and whether you agree with him or you don't agree with him, we send good thoughts his way for fast healing, that he gets back to his campaign if that's what he wishes to do, and will get back to his campaign and campaigning in good health. That is paramount. So Bernie, heal, get better, And we wish you everything good, that you get back to wherever you choose to be in good health. I saw that news item and I said, oh, this is not a good time for this kind of thing to happen. You know, you just don't want to envision, here he is at a prime point in his life, and this happens out of nowhere. And that's how things happen. Very often you're in the middle of doing something with no indication at all that you are about to have a major health crisis, a major health episode, and boom, here it is. And suddenly, everything has to take second place. Everything comes after taking care of yourself. And in our case, I think we would want to send him good thoughts. People would say prayers. I say, okay, say prayers. But send him good wishes for a quick revival. The state of Florida, as of yesterday, made it legal for teachers to carry guns, openly carry guns for their protection on school premises. They may do that as of yesterday. They first must be trained and certified in handling their weapons, according to state authorities. The measure was introduced after 17 students and school personnel were killed and 17 others injured in a mass attack at the Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland last year, February 14th. Now, there was a lot of controversy about that. Should teachers be walking around with loaded guns on school premises, ostensibly to be prepared to defend themselves and students and anyone else on school property, should it come to that? Now, some people say this is making the school environment something of a battleground. Others are saying, look at the potential of what could happen. You have 17 killed, 17 wounded, so that's 34 people attacked specifically. And then you have all the ancillary damage being caused by people stampeding, people, you know, collapsing in fear. You have all this going on during this attack by one student with an automatic rifle. So it was debated very, very hotly in Florida. And the resolution was that teachers should have some kind of defense. But on the flip side of that was the argument that teachers are not supposed to be law enforcement personnel. They're not supposed to be guardians, military-type guardians of everyone's safety. I'd be interested in what you think about that. If you can place yourself in that position of deciding what is the correct policy, what is the best policy to adopt, would it be that the teachers would not in any way get themselves involved in responding to an attack by making an attack, a counterattack themselves, waiting for police and other law enforcement authorities to show up? Or should teachers have some means of defense of themselves and of their students. It's a very tough discussion, but in any event, it is now law in Florida that this is a legal thing to do. I'm sure it will continue to cause a great deal of arguments and discussions, but the intent, you look at the intent is to break the cycle of being sitting ducks when people, some of them are not in their right minds, some of them are responding violently for some kind of reason that nobody knows. Some of them have mental health issues. These are the attackers I'm referring to. And by the time you get around to people coming to the rescue of the students and the teachers at the school, a lot of damage could be done. So I'd be interested in your position on that. I want to bring attention also to some things that just have gone off the map in this discussion, the current discussion we're having nationally about what should happen to the president and the charges that are against him being so serious, and we're just now scraping the surface of that. Are we supposed to just sit and wait and see how it turns out? Basically, technically having no precedent at all. Should he be removed from office while the charges are investigated and in some cases, adjudicated? Technically, are we without a president? Can the president in this situation continue to be president and to be credible as president? Would his actions be considered perfectly legal, as if nothing ever happened? All right. Well, here's a good place to take a break and come back to your comments. We'll be right back at 888-874-4888. That's the number to call. 888-874-4888. You're listening to Leid Stories on PRN.FM. We are having a little technical difficulty, which we think we have patched up for the moment, but it's only a patch, and I'm asking you to remember that we want to do this the right way, which would require funds. So I'm asking you to be as generous as you can and make a donation with that in mind. Moki from Connecticut, you are on the air.
Greetings, Eutrice.
Hello.
I'm going to comment on the first article that you introduced today. And I think it's UB40 that released a song called Rat in the Kitchen. Great little tune. So, you know,
wasn't that poetic justice, though? The rat falling out of the ceiling in the White House in front of all these reporters who were asked to essentially carry the Trump line previously when Mr. Trump castigated and berated poor communities as being rat infested.
It's a glorious event, it was, and it's fraught with potential for a new understanding. What I want to remind you and the audience of, I think you all know this, but I just want to bring it to the fore. This existence, this thing we call reality, it's all about energy. And everything is symbolic, many times on more than one level. Everything is symbolic, and nothing, of course, is really what it seems to be. Everything has a secret, an inside story, a history. So on one level, I see this rat as maybe not, if not Jeffrey Epstein himself, the phenomenon. it's sending everybody scurrying, the revelations.
Well, I didn't expect a deep analysis, so deep as yours. I just thought it to be amusing
that
the president had castigated poor black neighborhoods this way, and the political representation that they had, basically to say any politician coming out of these communities, you just have to regard them as politicians who couldn't do any better, and they settle for representing rat-infested communities. And boom, right there in the White House, before witnesses who are able to report accurately what happened, a rat fell right out of the ceiling. I thought that was hilarious. Thanks for getting us started today, yeah. Moki. I appreciate it. Mark, you're on the air from Manhattan.
Yes. Greetings, beloveds.
Thank you.
I want to comment to the discussion yesterday, and of course the mouse, the rat, which fell into journalist Jim Acosta's lap. Boy, that's pretty scary. I consider that an omen for what's about to come, hopefully. But as to your comments and discussion yesterday, and by the way, Al Green didn't lose any heart because just recently he came out reiterating the importance of acknowledging the bigotry which has related and been connected to so much violence. I wanted to share that about 4 or 5 months ago, WNYC on the media program had a whole program about the statute and charge of inciting violence. And it was very, very interesting because they gave examples of if you and I stood up there before an audience, a crowd, and did even something close to what Trump had done, we would be subject to a very serious criminal charge of inciting violence. I mean, going back to his campaign where he said, oh, they spoke fondly of the good old days and when they used to be able to carry people out on a stretcher, and on, many of these mass shooters and massacres were absolutely tied to parroting the absolute rhetoric of Trump in terms of invaders. And just before the El Paso shooting, he was in the panhandle at a rally, and one of his rabble piped up and said, Trump would say, oh, what can we do with these awful migrants? And the person piped up and said, shoot them. And he just was delighted by that. And two or three days later, some of his unmoored listeners actually did what was suggested. Now, the latest thing that I haven't heard you mention is it came out in the New York Times that Trump wanted to create a moat at the border with snakes and alligators. I mean, this is something that you couldn't make
with
up.
With venomous snakes and alligators.
And alligators.
Tells you what's going on in his mind.
Yeah, I mean, this man is just a total wreck, and he wanted to, when he found out he couldn't just shoot him outright, that then he would shoot him in the leg to slow him down. And, I mean, all the people around him tried to say, well, Mr. Trump, President, you can't do that, and that's why they soon after lost their positions. Remember the Homeland Security detail, all of them was gone in a flash. He wanted to have at the top of the fence a flesh-piercing barbs and electrified and on so I mean if the Democrats don't do multiple articles of impeachment, and I mean multiple, one of the callers mentioned Lawrence McDonald, who has worked with the Senate. And he brought out that sometimes a senator would vote for one or two articles, which was sufficient, so they should be given a choice of all the criminality, the corruption, the emoluments, the abuses of power, and in particular, the lying and the violence where the University of North Texas has documented that when he speaks in a county, 226% increase in hate crimes, okay? In New York State, a 10 and a 12-year-old on a school bus upstate attacked another 10-year-old kid. The matron looked the other way, and it goes on and on.
But you know what? We haven't held the political world to account. Whether it's Republican and Democrat, progressive, whatever, how did it come to be that they saw exactly the same things you and I saw, and you and I and others came to the conclusion something is wrong? That was the first thing I said. Something is wrong with this guy. Psychiatrists have talked about it, and they've demanded that something be done. Nothing.
Duty to warn. Duty to warn. Correct.
So nobody gets away here. They allowed. Yes, they did say, the psychiatrists have put out their report, the duty to warn and whatnot. I'm still saying nobody took legislative action to get this man removed from office and into treatment, because he clearly was a danger, still is, a danger to this country. But nobody did anything, even though they had suspicions, they had meetings, they had, they had all kinds of convocations, and they discussed Donald Trump and what a danger he was to the country. Nobody really insisted that this become a primary issue in Congress. What do you do when the president is out of his mind? What do you do?
And you, Therese, there's a psychiatrist, Dr. Justin Frank, who I heard on Tom Hartman, and he's done a series of books on all the recent presidents, Obama on the couch, Clinton on the couch, and Trump on the couch is his latest. And he says that this guy, Trump, he needs to be in a structured clinical environment. That's how crazy he is.
But people have been saying this for years, even before the man became president. People who have worked in New York City with Trump, they know this guy's off his rocker. And then to find out he is the president of the United States, the military people knew immediately what kind of challenge they would be faced with President Trump at the helm. So I think we have to ask, really, why are they still there? They knew that the president was a danger to himself and specifically to the country.
To the world.
And we didn't see it go anywhere because, well, people were afraid or people were embarrassed or taking responsibility for literally saving this nation and the world from who knows what he had next. What newfangled idea would pop up in his head, and people are supposed to go along with that.
He's so in la la la.
What do you do?
Yeah.
What do you do? You know, where was Nancy Pelosi? Where were all these people who are in charge of telling us what to do and who are in charge of guiding the country sensibly? And they did nothing really to address the major problem at hand, which is our president is mentally unfit for this job. He's unfit for any job. And still, they're talking as if, well, he's a normal guy. We're going to go prosecute him as if he were a normal guy.
Yeah,
if I were his lawyer, I would easily say, well, you know, the president hasn't been normal for a while. He takes pills and he goes to therapy once every 4 years. And that's the extent of it. But really, we don't think your charge has merit. You don't have the right to compel him now to go into treatment. What is going on here?
And he has a shadow foreign policy, sending Barr and Giuliani all around the planet to try to refute basically the Mueller report and the Russian interference in 2016.
Well, all I could tell you is they all need to be in treatment together.
They all need to be in treatment together.
Because there's no rational explanation as to why these people occupying the strategic positions that they do allow this insanity to occur. Everybody knows it. All the countries of the world know it. But America is being led. The president is disabled, mentally disabled person, and needs to be, for the good of the country, needs to be removed. Come up with a plan. They're great at planning. Plan that the president will no longer be president for a while. While somebody, tries to fix his brain. And then you go back to the business of regular elections.
Well, you have to repair the damage first, you know. There's been a lot of damage, you know.
The first thing is to stop the hemorrhaging. Mm. And it means that Trump has to be removed. And for his own good, his own safety, put into training. I'm serious. Put into treatment. He cannot be allowed to function, and everybody has to pretend that he's okay. He's not okay. He hasn't been okay for years. You know, but they would rather do that, and it comes to a racial issue. They would rather have a crazy white man than a sane anybody else.
Yeah. I tell you,
we're
quite a pickle.
You can reason with it. I wonder how many times this country came within a hair's breadth of setting off a nuclear war, and we didn't know it.
Yeah, well, he wanted to deal with the hurricane but with a nuclear bomb. That was one of his better ideas, I mean, he thought.
Sure. You use a sledgehammer to kill an ant. It's silly, man, but very dangerous. And what is more dangerous to me is us.
Mm.
We are watching this thing as if it is some kind of movie.
Mm-hmm.
As if it isn't happening. It isn't real. No major damage could come out of it. And it doesn't affect us. No, it affects the world. That's what people don't get. Mm-hmm. But hopefully, you know, we come back to our senses pretty soon enough. And put Donald Trump in isolation and in deep, deep treatment, if it would help. I don't know if it can. No, because he's been like this for how many years? He's in his 70s.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you know it started with mom and dad, who shaped or helped shape his psychological attitudes and profile.
Liz Smith, the former so-called Gotham columnist, Woman About Town, she said, Donald Trump is a seven-year-old that now has grown old. So he has that infantile syndrome.
Right. I'm glad that she has a great analysis. What did she do with it prior to now? Why has she shut up until now? Everybody's an expert now. You know, they can look back and see where it started. The fact is, between the time you saw where it started and now, he has done immeasurable harm. Not just to people, but to even himself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And yet this country is accepting his leadership without much resistance. We accept Donald Trump and his craziness.
Mm-hmm. It's chaos. The type of white supremacy, because, like you said, they expected Obama to be a criminal, and he couldn't even get a moderate Supreme Court justice moving forward. And here you have someone who's absolutely insane. And because he's a white man, they just you know, there's just acceptance.
But they know the truth. They know that he is not right in his head and hasn't been for a long time. They know the truth of that. They know how true it is that he shouldn't be anywhere close to the White House. They know. And so they said nothing. And now for political reasons, you know, they get on the high horse. And even so, they're not going at Donald Trump to talk about the real problem here. They're staying away from his madness.
Mm-hmm.
And they're talking about policies that didn't work.
Criminal policies.
Yeah. But they knew the policies all along. They knew all of this all along. And look at the damage this man has done to this country in just a little more than 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you could go outside and round up a couple of six-year-olds, and they would do a better job. But I tell you, it is what is phenomenal is the degree of denial the assistants Donald Trump and his ilk have gotten in perpetrating a tremendous fraud on this country and on the world. And it is to somebody's credit, I don't know whose, but it is to somebody's credit that we haven't been obliterated by enemies or self-obliterated. Because
we've been very lucky, no question.
And that is not the way you should want to be governed or you should want to govern. Thanks, Ma'at, for your call. That brings us to the end of our program today. I want this to be a major issue because it has happened to us way too often. And it means that there is a systemic problem we have to tackle and fix. I'm not a technical person at all, but we do have technical people. And what needs to be done requires funds. I ask you sincerely and fervently to consider making a contribution to PRN so we can get these things fix once and for all, okay? We'll see each other tomorrow. Bye-bye.